Welcome everyone on this absolutely gorgeous spring afternoon on the coast of Maine, for those of us here in the local area, and for those of you tuning in from afar, welcome. Thank you for joining us. We're very excited this evening to have a special guest for one of our science cafes, Dr., as we call him, Chuck Dinsmore, who has been a long-term associate of MDIBL, coming here in the mid-70s as an investigator, a newly minted PhD student who studied with one of the leaders in regenerative medicine, a gentleman by the name of Richard Goss. And so we are very excited to have Chuck share with us his perspective and his research on the history of regenerative biology. As many of you know, the MDI BioLab has a very strong focus in regenerative biology and aging. We have a center here, the Catherine W. Davis Center for Regenerative Biology and Aging, and we now have 11 full-time faculty members who are conducting research in that general, in those general areas of research. So, Chuck, I don't want to get too formal here, but I just want to welcome you and thank you so much for putting this together. I'm super excited. I know I'm going to learn a lot about how all of this came together and sort of, you know, bringing us to where we are today. So super, super happy to have you with us. Thank you very, very much.
Well, Jerry, thank you very much for the kind invitation to come out of retirement and share some earlier thoughts on the history of regeneration. Research, and a special thanks to Emily for educating me a little bit on Zooming in the 21st century. I hope I've been a good student. We're going to find out. A conceptual history of animal regeneration. I'm going to try to cover about 3,000 years of that history in 30 minutes or so. We're going to find out how that works. Before plunging into the main course, I'd like to point out a couple of investigators from the regeneration research that has been done over the years at the MDIBL. Indeed, there is a long line of regeneration researchers. I've selected four events that I think are useful, at least from my narrative. They're from the annual reports, the MDIBL bulletins, and David Evans' book. Nod to Dave there. The first one that I found in the annual reports was back in 1908, where Max Morse did some regeneration research using a hydrozoan. That occurred at the Harpswell lab, the predecessor of the MDIBL before it moved to Salisbury Cove. The next stop I'm going to make is in 1937. A researcher named Oscar Chatte gave a lecture at the lab. Oscar went on to become prominent as a regeneration researcher focused on the endocrine system and its influence on limb regeneration in salamanders. Jumping to 1957, Dick Goss, who was mentioned in the introduction, Jerry kindly introduced him for me. He went on to become perhaps the foremost regeneration expert in the world. His range and depth of animals that he investigated was incredible. He also was my mentor. And finally, Kevin Strange returned to the lab in 2009 as its first full-time year-round director, and very shortly thereafter established the Catherine W. Davis Center for Regenerative Biology and Medicine, now Aging. Much of what I'm going to tell you about this evening is covered in more detail in this little volume, A History of Regeneration Research. It was the result of a symposium that I organized back in 1988, a gathering of some of the top regeneration researchers, and I had asked them to talk about the history of their particular specialty. Invited a couple of card-carrying historians and philosophers of science as well, just to keep us honest. Surprisingly, this came out in paperback in 2008, so that now I can afford a copy as well. Having trouble forwarding. There we go. And there's Oscar Chatte again. The symposium was held in December of 1988. Oscar had unfortunately died that year earlier. One of Oscar's favorite sayings was, "I give my right arm to discover the secret of regeneration." So that's the challenge for the Center for Biology, Regenerative Biology and Medicine at the lab. Patient presents missing his right arm. The researchers at the MDIBL have discovered the secret of regeneration, and the patient goes home happily now with his right arm. With that burned into your mind, let me go to a definition, a little housekeeping here. For my purposes, there are two fundamental differences in reparative regeneration. One is called tissue regeneration. Most tissues and organs have some capacity to regenerate minor injury. Skin, for example, and yes, to the other professors in the neighborhood, I know those are organs and not tissues, but I'm going to call it tissue regeneration anyway. A scratch heals completely. Deeper wounds may leave some scarring. Bones are another example of tissue regeneration. Fracture healing goes along quite nicely, especially if you're young. The other type of reparative regeneration is called epimorphic regeneration, a much more complex integrated form where complex morphology is lost, and then a process that is characterized by a set of reactions that differentiate it from the tissue regeneration will occur, and that complex form is completely replaced. So with regeneration defined, I'm going to ask your forbearance. This will be my narrative so that I can organize things a little bit more memorably. I'm going to declare three threes of animal regeneration and walk you slowly through those. The three threes are three ways of conceptualizing animal regeneration. I'm going to situate those concepts in three arbitrarily selected periods. These are not mutually exclusive, but I'm going to kind of pretend that they are. And then finally, three individuals from the 18th century whose regeneration research I think you should know about, not only for the discoveries that they made in animal regeneration, but for their methodology, which according to many historians, established the fundamentals of modern experimental zoology. So the three ways of conceptualizing animal regeneration for my purposes will be observation-induced imagination. For example, the concept that birds can fly. I wonder what would it be like if I could fly? Daedalus and Icarus come to mind. So imagination comes to play with regeneration. Some animals can regenerate. I know I can't. I wonder what it'd be like if I could, and I can imagine doing so. The next concept that I'm going to declare is shared empirical knowledge. Everyone knows that. Everyone knows birds fly, fish swim in the water. Everyone knows that certain animals can regenerate, others can't. And I know I can't, as far as limbs and digits are concerned. And then finally, the concept of thinking, a reflective study where experimentation, the active interrogation of nature arises, and that will be kind of the finale. So the three periods where animal regeneration appear, and this takes us again through the concepts, imagining, knowing, and thinking. Imagining, I'm just going to take a quick look at ancient Greece, putting that into the period where Homer and Hesiod were active. The mythology includes a whole range of supernatural powers of the gods that included regeneration. Knowing, we'll start looking at living nature and set the superpowers of the gods aside and begin cataloging, documenting examples of regeneration. And then finally, on to thinking and experimenting, going to make a grand leap to the third period, the center of the Enlightenment, the middle of the 18th century. So fasten your seatbelts. We're going to go through a very quick survey of regeneration in 3,000 years or less. Imagining, we go to Greek mythology, where there are a couple, more than a couple of examples of regeneration. I'm going to just mention two, the famous Hydra of Lerna, a multi-headed serpent, the heads of which regenerated if they were cut off, and Prometheus's liver, another example of regeneration in Greek mythology. Just to again anchor this, there's Homer with the Iliad and the Odyssey and a number of gods intervening and playing around with humans, having their superpowers. This is kind of like the Marvel comics of the ancient world, but they took their gods and monsters a lot more seriously than we might. And there's Hesiod, perhaps a little less well known, his Theogony and Works of Days. The Theogony articulates very elaborately the birth of the gods and the hierarchies and so forth, as well as the demons and monsters that they encountered. So those are the two who essentially documented the Greek mythology for us. Here is that first of the regeneration events. There is Heracles, or in the Roman form, Hercules, slaying the Hydra. This nine-headed, plus or minus, depending upon who's telling the story. He was assigned as his second labor for crossing the higher-ups in the god hierarchy. A second labor of 12 to kill this monster. Couldn't quite do it on his own. He recruited his nephew Aeolus and found out how he could kill it. But anyway, the point is head regeneration. In this particular rendering from this ceramic, just for my own edification, I did not know that backwriting was in vogue at that period. You can see Heracles' name written backwards, and then Athena's cheering him on in that particular rendering. The next case of regeneration in ancient Greek mythology, Prometheus. Again, Prometheus crossed the higher ups. He stole fire from the upper gods and gave it to humans. So for punishment, he was bound to a column in the Caucasus Mountains where every day an eagle or a vulture would come down, pluck out his liver, and every night it regenerated. Now, it's unlikely that there were any surgeons of the day who could perform partial hepatectomies and have their patients survive, much less survive long enough to discover that the liver did regenerate. Humans do have incredible liver regenerative capacity, but nevertheless, here's another case of regeneration from Greek mythology. This one was in a rendering of Hesiod's Theogony. We go from imagining to knowing, jump forward a couple hundred years, and the shift in emphasis from the supernatural and the gods and their mythologies to a real representation of nature. Knowing, as I'm going to characterize it, is empirical. It's the everybody knows that. Birds fly, fish swim. Some animals can regenerate, others can't. Let's write it down. Let's start cataloging. And this is going to be, again, the focus. Some animals can regenerate lost parts, others can't. I'm going to turn to Aristotle for his commentary. He did a lot of commentary. The volume of his works is incredible. Five of his books include a focus on animals, and in a couple of them, and I'm going to abstract from History of Animals, Parts of Animals also is another book that he mentions regeneration. Some affirm that hatchling birds and serpents can regenerate their eyes. And he also notes here, lizards and serpents can regenerate their tails if they cut off. Let me point out, some affirm that this happens. They say that that happens. He didn't necessarily observe these himself. He's hedging his bets, and rightly so, because he did include a lot of mythology, things that he had on hearsay. He hadn't verified, but he thought it was good enough to document. So documenting and cataloging. Here's another one that's a little more familiar, perhaps. He mentions deer in several places in a couple of the different books. Deer do shed, and here he says they shed their horns. Other places he calls them antlers. They renew them annually since about the age of 2 years. Now, let me anchor this a little more solidly as a grand example of epimorphic regeneration. Dick Goss became a renowned expert on deer antler regeneration. This is one of the fallow deer in his research, still shedding its winter coat. This is in May, and the same animal in July has regenerated this massive rack. It is a complex of tissues. The tissue interactions included full skin. Hyaline cartilage is produced. It's a highly vascularized, innervated cartilage, which is curious for hyaline cartilage. But my point here is the morphology, the exquisite shaping that when this deer sheds its antlers in the late winter, it will the following year reproduce this form. Hence, again, epimorphic regeneration. So now I'm going to vault over about 1500 years, saying that science as a respectable profession, if you will, goes into a pause. The scientific stasis, it's displaced and replaced by scholasticism and dogma. According to Galileo, it was important to discover how to get to heaven rather than how the heavens go. He paid dearly for it, not quite as badly as some others in the science field, but in any event, science was not advancing. If you wanted to know anything about the natural world, you look back to Aristotle. So animal regeneration takes us now from knowing to thinking. The context was the Renaissance and the Reformation, which had begun to loosen things up a bit from the Dark Ages. They paved the way for the scientific revolution, which largely focused on the physical world, astronomy, mathematics, physics, and the notables of that revolution, Copernicus on through Galileo, Newton. But that also loosened things up and paved the way for the Enlightenment. It was beginning to be acceptable to look at the physical world, but the living world was still somewhat off limits. The theological naturalism was still in power. In this period of the Enlightenment, living nature opened up a bit more to the investigation of naturalists. And I'm going to introduce you now to those three 18th century naturalists whose experiments in animal regeneration did really open things up, demand a focus of attention for a number of reasons, and then established a methodology that would be recognizable and utilized today. The first one, Abraham Tremblay, a Genevan, went to the school of Calvin in Geneva. He was from the upper class, which gave him certain privileges, and he received a very solid education in the math and sciences. He did a thesis on the infinitesimal calculus, which may bring in a little bit of Leibnizian influence. I may mention that a little bit. His cousin, a younger gentleman named Charles Bonnet, also became involved in animal regeneration research. They had established early on an elaborate correspondence and shared their personal findings, and then broadened their correspondence ultimately to include the Republic of Letters, as well as the academies of the day, both in Paris and in London. Finally, Lazzaro Spallanzani, an Italian who had studied for law, but also took vows in the priesthood, which gave him a certain amount of cover when he started investigating particular kinds of animal behavior. So Abraham Tremblay, Charles Bonnet, Lazzaro Spallanzani. The elaborate correspondence among them is largely maintained at the library in Geneva. The philosophical context into which animal regeneration was tossed is an interesting one. There is the perpetual search for truth. We have either the received wisdom, natural law, according to theosophical naturalism, and core to that is animal generation, reproduction. the discovery of regeneration is going to throw the concepts into great turmoil. And the received wisdom or natural law, that was in Calvinist Geneva, among other places. And there may be a Leibnizian influence that I may refer to briefly. Competing models of generation, that is animal reproduction, included preformation or epigenesis. Preformation was the acceptable conservative way of looking at reproduction. All organisms were created at the creation, one contained within the other, and they sequentially unfolded over time such that at the end of time, at Revelation, the last of the Matryoshka dolls would emerge and that would be it. There were two general flavors of that preformation, ovist or spermist or animalculist. Either all generations were contained in the first female or in the first male. The competing newer way of looking at things was epigenesis. Epigenesis. This allowed for a little bit of self-regulation, challenging the creation story. It was cast by the conservatives as too liberal, materialist, and indeed atheistic. You could not attribute things that God didn't have his finger on to living things themselves. But the epigenesis camp said, well, maybe things weren't all created at the beginning after all. So that's the philosophical context into which our regeneration researchers tossed their experiments. So thinking, Abraham Trombley in 1740 was the one who discovered a real hydra and it could regenerate. The same year, his cousin, Charles Bonnet, proved parthenogenesis. It had been speculated that there were certain animals, the aphid in particular, that could reproduce asexually. He was one who did exquisitely detailed observations on aphids and proved the case unequivocally. At the same time, through his correspondence with his cousin Trombley, who had shared that discovery of regeneration, he started doing his own exploration of regeneration. He couldn't find any hydra in the Geneva neighborhood, and he never really got too far from home. So he started trying other insects, including worms, and along the way discovered hydra aren't the only animals that can undergo this remarkable regeneration. Finally, Spallanzani, who had read some of Bonnet's works, among other natural history works that he had become very infatuated with, started the correspondence that lasted through Bonnet's lifetime. Bonnet had written metaphysical works where he tried to shoehorn regeneration into the acceptable conservative preformation mode. Spallanzani read those works, which included his regeneration studies, and tried those regeneration experiments on some of the local Italian insects, boat worms, and then he pushed it to something more like us. He discovered that a vertebrate, a salamander, can regenerate, and that was kind of the icing on the cake. Let me now introduce them a little more detail as to what they were doing at the time they made these discoveries. This is Abraham Trombley in profile toward the end of his life. He had, as I mentioned, gone to the School of Calvin in Geneva, where he was very well educated and a good student in math and natural history. He subsequently left Geneva for the Netherlands, another bastion of Huguenot refugees, another Protestant bastion, and attended courses at the University of Leiden, where he became known and brought under the wing of some of the greatest naturalists of his day. But in order to support himself, he took a position as the tutor of a couple of young children for a count, Count Bentinck, in a beautiful little estate near The Hague. This shows Trombley with his students. Part of their education involved studying natural history, and they went out into the canals and fields and forests around the estate collecting little specimens to study at the house. The education began in the late 30s with Trombley's arrival, and his discovery of hydroregeneration took place in 1740. But in his subsequent publication of his collected works in 1744, A Memoir pour Servir, et cetera, et cetera, this first memoir in that book describes in great detail the animals that he found. And at the time he discovered them, he wasn't sure they were animals or plants. This was one of the hydra that he discovered among a couple of other species, but it was green. Symbiotic algae made it so, but he didn't know about symbiosis at the time. So this, for all the world, is an upside down palm tree. Its behavior, though, kind of indicated this is probably not a plant. It could be an animal. But in the Leibnizian chain of being, maybe this is the point of passage in that creation from plants to animals. Don't know. Maybe I'll do some experiments to test whether it's a plant or an animal. So here he is with his students in the little study that he had set up, examining some of those creatures with his students, kept them in little jars and watched them over time. Let me illustrate just a couple of the experiments that he did. He went on to do about 24 different experiments, discovering things that are still fundamental to anyone studying hydroregeneration today. This is in his fourth memoir in that book that came out in 1744. This is a plate which shows one of the hydra that he had cut in half. So there's the head, and there's the cut middle of the animal. This is the tail, and there's the other cut end. He expected it to die if it were in an animal, or live if it were a plant. He was just taking cuttings. Here's the tail, and there's the cut end, which over time starts growing new tentacles. And eventually, these two cuttings became complete individuals, two from one, from a cutting. This threw the philosophical community into great tizzy, because does that mean the soul, the animal soul, is sectile? Can you cut an animal in half and have its souls cut as well? Here's another example of his experiments. He cut one longitudinally, or more than a couple. He reproduced his experiments. He cut one longitudinally, head to tail. So four tentacles down here from the original eight. And over time, this half closed over and started regenerating more tentacles. Another experiment, he cut it partway through and it regenerated two new heads, which he cut again, which regenerated two new heads, which he cut again. And there is your mythological hydra. This is the hydra of Lernae that Heracles had to slay. Trombley was calling these a polyp, but with some of these experiments behind, it became known as the hydra. So what's Leibniz got to do with it? I mentioned that Trombley had done his thesis on the infinitesimal calculus. I won't go into the mathematical details, but with Leibniz's philosophical, metaphysical principles, he described a continuity, a plenitude, and a gradation of all things that were formed at the creation, from earth, fire, water, on up through minerals, plants, animals. So in his education, I would say that Trombley could not help but to have learned about this chain of being, and perhaps this hydra that he discovered was that point of passage. What was the significance of Trombley's hydra? The discovery that some animals could regenerate two individuals from a bisected animal was extraordinary in itself. He also discovered that they reproduced by budding, just like plants do. This was quite contrary to natural law and required a total inversion of a whole range of concepts about what animals were capable of. But I think perhaps more importantly, was the detail in his methodology. When he made his discoveries, he wrote them in great detail in letters to his cousin, among others. He sent descriptions, multi-page descriptions, to the Academy in Paris, which was presided over by the great Réaumur. Réaumur at first was curious about whether this was a plant or an animal too, but ultimately decided it was a plant. Trombley had sent not only elaborate descriptions of every experiment that he did, but he sent animals, basically doing the doubting, is this reproducible? It needs to be reproduced by independent minds. One of the great historians of French history of science called this the period when the motto should be souviens-toi de te méfier, always doubt yourself. And if anything, Trombley exemplified that. So the significance, not only the discovery, but the methodology. Let me anchor this a little more detail. In 1743, Trombley was awarded the Copley Medal from the Royal Society of London for his experiments on the polypus. Copley Medal is not as well known perhaps as the Nobel Prize, but others who received the Copley Medal: Benjamin Franklin, Joseph Priestley, Humboldt, Einstein, Stephen Hawking. You get the picture. This was a big deal. The Hydra regenerated. Another troubling discovery, Bonnet in the meantime had proved unequivocally parthenogenesis takes place. Asexual reproduction can occur in animals. And then he picked up the regeneration studies as well. So there was an elaboration of animal regeneration on top of this asexual reproduction. Here's Bonnet, a dour looking character. His sight became quite problematic fairly early in his life. And after some of his early experiments on aphid parthenogenesis and regeneration, he turned to more philosophical issues and reverted to the conservative metaphysics. In any event, he published some of his works in an essay, a small tome actually, Traité d'insectologie, in which he included his aphid studies, where plant pots containing plants which he inoculated with aphids were then isolated. He would set aside a plant with one aphid, and as soon as it gave birth to another little aphid, he isolated that one, serially isolating virgin aphids. And I don't recall how many he did, but his observations were hour by hour, day by day. His persistence was just incredible. And then he reproduced this chain of being from the Leibnizian influence in that work. Ginny Dawson reproduced it with the English translation showing the fire, air, water, on up through minerals to plants. And there's the polyp right there in the middle, the transition from plants to animals. So Bonnet's rendering and then the translation. Bonnet couldn't find, as I mentioned, he couldn't find any hydra in the neighborhood in Geneva. So he tried a few other insects, including worms. So this is a plate showing his worm regeneration studies. And then here was another interesting, any animal was subjected to regeneration studies. Can this one regenerate? Snails can regenerate their heads. And here's where some, the Republic of Letters was very extensive and word got out. Even Voltaire became engaged in it. Those of you who are Voltaire scholars might recall, he wrote a satirical colimaçon on snail head regeneration, suggesting that this would be a great capacity for politicians. They might be able to regenerate a head with a brain in it for a change. So, wait, there's more. Those are lower forms. That's okay. We don't, you know, really need to take those too seriously. Or do we? Enter Lazzaro Spallanzani. As I mentioned, he struck up correspondence with Bonnet after having been impressed by Bonnet's philosophical as well as regeneration studies, tried a few for himself, forwarded those letters, elaborate letters to Bonnet for his comment, and their correspondence lasted a lifetime. This is the series that appeared in his sketches in one of his first letters to Bonnet. Philippe Monnier, the curator of manuscripts at the University of Geneva, the library in Geneva, very generously photocopied these, and I clipped them out and made this little montage of Spallanzani's tail regeneration in salamanders. Important here is that he noted not only is it regenerating, but look at that. The spinal cord regenerates. Who'd have thought? And some other illustrations along the way. Again, this was in a letter that he sent to Bonnet. As far as I know, this is the first example of salamander tail regeneration being documented. He also did studies on tadpole tail regeneration. A couple of years later, he came out with this Prodromo, which was a description of a wide range of studies on animal reproduction. This included some of his studies on spontaneous generation as well as regeneration. It didn't have any illustrations, and he promised this was just a preliminary report. A full detailed report would come out sooner or later. And Bonnet kept encouraging him to do just that, and kept encouraging him, and kept encouraging him, and kept encouraging him, and it didn't happen. That was the last of Spallanzani's engagement with regeneration research. So Bonnet took it upon himself. Okay, do salamanders really regenerate? He described and had illustrations made of limb regeneration. And this could be right out of Dick Goss's work. The detail of both limb and tail regeneration is extraordinary. So that kind of sums up my rapid running through animal regeneration from a few historical perspectives. The salamanders have returned in force to the MDIBL. I'm proud to see that, and I'm looking forward to meeting a couple of the other salamander regeneration researchers. So in conclusion, let me just say that animal regeneration has been perceived and construed in different ways over time. I've arbitrarily indicated a couple of those concepts and situated them in different times. The mythology was for conceptualizing as the imagination, and then Aristotle jumped in to document what happens in real animals. Abraham Tremblay's work then in the 18th century brought attention back to regeneration after a period of scientific stasis. And when the regeneration discoveries went out into the Republic of Letters and to the academies in both Paris and London, regeneration took off everywhere, including out into the United States eventually. It disturbed both scientific and philosophical intellectual scenes and went on to great things. But for my purposes, it's not just the facts of animal regeneration, but the exemplary methodology that they introduced. This was, as I mentioned, according to some historians of science, the signing of the birth certificate of experimental biology, or more precisely, experimental zoology. And finally, animal regeneration research has a long thread in its history in the MDIBL and continues to contribute to that beautiful tapestry. The support that I had for going to Geneva and reading the extraordinary correspondence as well as the documents of the manuscripts was supported by the NSF, allowing me to look at that archival material as well as that at the University of Chicago. And again, Philippe Monnier was very generous in his support of my work. Finally, if you really want to delve into this in great detail, this bibliography will be available to you. So Ginny Dawson, Looking at Nature's Enigma, Details of the Polyp Studies, The Little History of Regeneration. David Evans with a more detailed history of the MDIBL. The Lenhoffs, Sylvia and Howard Lenhoff, who had contributed a chapter to that history of regeneration research, translated the entire work that Tremblay had produced And finally, Shirley Rowe gets into more detail about that philosophical issue of the matter of generation, the pre-formation epigenesis debate in the 18th century. If there are any questions, please let me stop sharing if I can. And return to
Chuck. That was fantastic. Thank you so much. What a great glimpse into sort of the
honestly, like, you know, I've been working on regeneration for so many years. This was marvelous. Seriously.
Oh, that's great.
Prag, it's good to meet you, Prag.
Yeah, same pleasure here.
That's terrific. Chuck, we do have a couple of questions that have come through the chat. So I want to just pose those to you. The first one is from Dave Evans, and he's curious, when the deer that you showed, when it molts, does it repeat the pattern, the same sort of pattern every time exactly, or is it different each time?
Each year, it's going to be a little bit more elaborate. Good question. There were quite a number of studies that Dick Goss had done looking at the regeneration. The morphology is basically repeated a little more elaborately each year. And depending upon the species, quite interestingly, reindeer, both male and female, develop antlers. And they also are right-handed or left-handed antlers.
Really?
Too much information, perhaps. No, it was fun working with the deer with Goss.
That's terrific. So I have a couple more. Mike Hayes asks, it's clear the evolutionary advantage associated with regeneration, but why has it not continued throughout other animals such as mammals?
My challenge of philosophical answer is animals can regenerate their limbs because they don't need them. And I'll let that hang there for a while. If you're a terrestrial animal, can you afford the time that it would take, for example, a deer to regenerate a leg? It's going to be lunch for the next predator down the line. If, however, and this is a very simplistic way of looking at it, if, however, you are a salamander, I can cut all four limbs off and it can pretend it's a snake or a worm long enough to take the time to regenerate those structures. It's not a satisfying answer for other things that can regenerate. For example, Bonnet, although he doesn't get credit for it, discovered lens regeneration in the eye back in the mid 1700s. Later regeneration researchers get credit for it, but Bonnet notes it in his correspondence. Why can some animals regenerate their lenses and others can't? Don't know.
And that's really the fundamental question that, you know, our scientists here at MD-IBL are trying to address as well, trying to understand where are the similarities and, you know, why is it that some of these, as we refer to, higher organisms are unable to do that. I have a feeling that there may be some folks who are far better equipped to answer that question in the audience than I am. I don't know. Any
actually,
takers on?
What I would say is that a number of the research lines at the MD-IBL now look at those details which would be supportive. For example, the vascular regeneration. Vascularization is critical to both tissue regeneration and epimorphic regeneration. So if you can enhance the vascularization, you might enhance regeneration. But then that brings in the question of tumorigenesis also promotes vascularization. Mm-hmm. It's a delicate balance, mm-hmm. My humble opinion.
Ian, I see you, but you're muted.
I'll chime in with a comment about James Godwin's work and what he's showing.
Good evening, Ian.
Hey, how you doing, Chuck? James has really pioneered this idea that the immune system is very much, and also Prayag's work shows involvement of other cell types. And so when you think about why we don't regenerate, one idea might be that we gave up the kind of regeneration salamanders can do for another benefit, that there may be an evolution in our immune system that favored better innate immunity, some sort of adaptation to dry land life. And we sort of sacrificed another way to regrow. And so evolution, you know, we succeed. We're pretty successful creatures. we could be more successful. And I think that's the point of our work.
Sure.
There was probably some advantage actually to losing a certain capability if we gained another one, which might be a stronger immune system of some sort.
Sure. Ray Sicard was also interested in the immune system and its potential role in regeneration. Agree completely. It's a trade-off. As I said, scarification, rapid wound healing is an advantage if you're a terrestrial animal trying to get away from potential predators. You can't take the time to regenerate like a salamander or even zebrafish, which, as I often say, they don't have a leg to stand on, but that's okay.
Bad science humor. Okay. We have some other questions here. One is, how did the Greeks stumble on liver regeneration? When was liver regeneration actually observed or proven?
A great question, the answer to which goes off into speculation. As I said, I cannot imagine there were surgeons in ancient Greece who could do partial hepatectomies. I would say one line of thinking is it's just coincidental that humans can regenerate. And this, again, gets to the, it's not as clear cut as I would pretend, human regeneration of the liver. You can remove one or two lobes. Those lobes do not regenerate. It's a compensatory hyperplasia of the remaining lobes. So yes, it's regeneration, but compensatory hyperplasia is a different line. So now we can continue parsing that. Don't know when the first, does any physician in the audience who would know that history, when the first hepatectomy was done?
We'll have to send Jim Boyer an email and ask him to answer that question. I'm not sure. We just a few more. I've got some questions piling up here. So during the scientific revolution and the philosophy of enlightenment period, as science advanced, please correct me if I'm wrong, it was a time when many myths and falsities were debunked, such as the contributions of, Copernicus, et cetera. So at this time, where all these big ideas were being debunked, why wasn't regeneration written off and debunked as well, seeing as there was no proof of it at this time period?
During the scientific revolution, you still risked your life doing science, and certainly you're more at risk for burning at the stake if you tried living nature in any of your studies, my humble opinion. My case will probably reinforce that. Homer Smith did some writing on things of that nature. Debunking only goes so far as we currently understand it in the current socio-political environment. Not sure which direction to take that. The debunking of a number of things that regeneration showed to those who were doing the regeneration research in the middle of the 18th century, rather. They continued trying to shoehorn those discoveries into the accepted conservative wisdom. So how do we say conspiracy theory?
Fascinating. One additional question here. Are they still showing students hydra regeneration now?
I retired a couple of decades ago. I don't know. I remember in high school, planaria were given to us, and that was my first regeneration, abjectly failed. We were allowed to take our bisected planaria home. I set it on top of the refrigerator overnight, and it dehydrated completely. So I don't know. It is certainly an extraordinarily easy study to be done with students.
I'll chime in a bit with more recent stuff on hydra and planaria. So what I think is great about science is you can always find these wonderful stories that Chuck's been telling us about and go back and apply modern molecular methods to them. They take classical problems and figure out, using new tools, how things work. And so I'd say the remarkable take-home message from studying Hydra in the 2000s is that Hydra, planaria, they use some of the same signaling molecules that we use to regenerate. And in some ways, they're much easier to study because they're a very simple creature, but it provides ways to understand how organs know where to form or how spatial information is processed in a very simple creature that's a lot easier to study. So they still have an active place in research. And we learned a lot about basic signaling mechanisms from them.
And the sequential signaling, very important. And Alejandro is continuing his planarian regeneration studies. Extraordinary stuff. And as you say, with technology creep having become technology gallop, the questions that were open, you know, I'd give my right arm to discover the secret of regeneration. Every generation has speculated that it's just around the corner, but incremental advances.
I was going to say, if you want or are interested in finding out what kind of molecular tools are available in Hydra, you should check out Selena Giuliano's website. She's at UC Davis, and the tags and the imaging that are now done on this animal as a model system are quite impressive.
Oh, that's cool. Dustin, if you have a second and want to pop that in the chat, that would be great.
Another thing that occurs to me, the incredible integration, regeneration was sitting there by itself, stem cell biology by itself, aging by itself, and the integration of all of those concepts coming to bear on general understanding of biology, the processes, just phenomenal and well over my head these days.
That's terrific. So there are a couple other questions. Barbara has one. What groups are interested in regeneration now? NASA, perhaps, besides organ regeneration? So that may be a broad, I know there are a lot of funding agencies that are very interested in regeneration.
I would defer to others more informed about that.
Mm-hmm. So I know Department of Defense, for example, is funding some work there. We certainly, you know, National Institutes of Health has many, many programs. Ian Drummond here at MDIBL is leading an initiative through the NIH to look at kidney regeneration. I don't know, Ian, if there are other groups that you're aware of that are interested in the concept of regeneration in general, as opposed to just organ regeneration.
Well, I think a couple of breakthroughs in the last 15 years have just said to everyone, the opportunity's there to regenerate the tissue you're most interested in. Mm-hmm. When Yamanaka discovered induced pluripotent cells and people started soaking them in different growth factors and creating different organs or organoids, it meant we could really start thinking about organ replacement. And so we're trying that in the kidney, but every institute at the NIH has a regenerative medicine focus. Certainly, Department of Defense would like to get wound healing down a little quicker. But I think just in general, and also studying aging, you know, is aging a problem of failed regeneration? So if we could promote regeneration, would we live healthier, perhaps not longer, but maybe healthier lives? So I think it's everywhere, frankly. And there's certainly a lot of popular interest as well.
Mm. And in my lifetime, it has been amazing just to see the global expansion. Every institution has a center for regenerative biology and medicine or aging or stem cell work. In my early days, cancer and regeneration, the overlap there, it remains. And that is always the signal, watch out. You can get it undergoing epimorphic regeneration, but that is tightly controlled. Cancer is uncontrolled. Where the switch that takes it from one direction to the other.
That's great. So we have one more question here from Ken Poss. Chuck, was there ever a historic debate on the age of a regenerated limb, younger and more invigorated than its original version, or regenerates to equivalent age / function?
Interesting question. A couple of things come to mind. It may or may not address the question completely, but even back, and I think it was Spallanzani who did it, amputated a limb, counted the number of bones regenerated, amputated again, counted. The limb could produce a couple hundred bones serially following those regenerations. Whether that represents younger genetically, that would then draw in the group that studies telomere shortening and or capacity to lengthen, more molecular stuff that again goes way over my head.
That's great. Chuck, thank you so much. I mean, this has been a really enlightening presentation. I think it's so much fun to think about this and perhaps a slightly different perspective. And I think you really got some great kudos from Prayag, who says that he learned some new information that he didn't know before. So that's really fantastic.
I did. I definitely did.
my thanks and great appreciation to you, Jerry, for the invitation and a chance to revisit these things and to meet my youngster colleagues.
Pleasure.
Thank you, Chuck.
There you go. Ian will take that one. Well, we're thrilled to have you here. Before I let everyone go, though, I do want to just sort of let you know we have another special, I won't call it a science cafe, but it's a collaborative event that builds on some of this idea of the history of science. And so many of you may be aware the Mount Desert Island Historical Society holds the collection of the original Champlain Society journals. And so they have gone back and digitized those journals. And now there's been an effort to put all of the data that was found in those journals in a database that's accessible. And so there are about four or five organizations on MDI that have collaborated on this project called the Landscape of Change. And next Monday on the 19th, we're going to have a joint virtual event with the MDI Historical Society, the Skudik Institute, and the Climate to Thrive. And we're going to really go back and look at the data in those early journals. And MDI Biological Laboratory, thanks very much to Mike Hayes, has also contributed a large body of collection information data on the different species that were found here in the bay from early 1920s until mid 1960s. And we've put together an interactive map with help from College of the Atlantic. And we are encouraging citizen scientists to go out and retrace the steps of members of the Champlain Society today and take some samples and see what species are still there, what species are no longer there. And we're going to provide opportunities for folks to enter that data. So this is a project that will be running all summer. But if you want to kind of get in on the early stages of it and learn about it, join us next Monday, the 19th, 5 o'clock. And we are going to unveil that project and encourage all of you to learn more. So I hope you'll join us. And then just another reminder that May is the beginning of our summer Science Cafe season. So we switch to two Science Cafes a month. So the next one will be on May 10th. And that will feature Tropical Rainforest Resilience and Vulnerability. And that is another MDIBL alum, a professor at College of the Atlantic. So please make sure to put these dates on your calendar. All of the information is there on the mdibl.org website under events. And we hope you enjoyed this Science Cafe. We hope you'll consider joining our Star Point Society and helping us support these kinds of events and outreach to the community. Thank you all so much, and we look forward to seeing you next week.